everyone. Welcome back to the podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. If you're watching on YouTube, hi, hello, welcome. To my left, you'll see that I have tea with me again today. And if you're listening on Spotify, thank you so much for that. That makes me very, very happy. It makes me feel very official to know that I am on Spotify, which I know is silly because anyone can do it, but it makes me feel really adult. So thank you for listening on Spotify. And if you are, I'm going to describe to you the latest tea. So the tea is from Etsy. It's from Mountain Tempo. It's called Strawberry Hibiscus. It's green tea, strawberry, hibiscus, and lemongrass. It's really, really good. For those of you with a sensitive palate, it might be a little tangy. I think it's the lemongrass because I have essential oils that smell just like the way this tastes. And so I think that's why it's a little bit more tart. Not sour, but kind of tart. The strawberries are really, 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 really good touch. I am afraid of dropping this tea. I am terrified because it is a beautiful pink color. If you guys want, check out my Instagram that I just started again. Look at me being so social media. Check that out if you want to see the color of the tea. But it is a very beautiful pink hue, and I am very afraid to spill it anywhere around me because I am not the most graceful human. So fingers crossed for me, guys. So in today's episode, and if you guys are curious, I'm not sure that it should matter, but it is, the Saturday before Mother's Day. So tomorrow's Mother's Day. I'm very excited. Obviously, shout out to all the moms in the world. You know, love you, appreciate you, appreciate my own mom. My mom is wonderful. I appreciate her presence in my life. And even though I could have made a Mother's Day episode today, I did decide to just continue on with the videos I had planned already, because as much as I could talk about my mother, I don't have anything to say that I haven't said to her. So I think it's less important to maybe tell the internet. Maybe next year I can think of some stories. But for now, I do want to talk about depression. And I want to start off by actually examining my past journals. This is from 2016. This is dated very funnily. It's dated 6/28/16 through 7/5/16, because at the time I wasn't very good at keeping up with my journals, and so I just kind of summarized what happened. But the very last thing I wrote is the most interesting thing to me, and I just keep my journals like in notepads. Honestly, I'm not very fancy. My mom is somebody who keeps lots of journals. Here we go, a little Mother's Day story. So my mom keeps tons of journals. They are my time machine back into my past. My mom plans to give them to me when she passes as a way of passing on our stories, and I think that's really cool. Sadly, my children will get a lot of really depressing journal entries. I was suffering at this time from depression, anxiety, and undiagnosed borderline personality disorder. So I hadn't yet gotten diagnosed. I was living in Seattle at the time, and I was just a little ways away from my mental health journey and healing, but I didn't know this yet. So 2016, note to self. I hate being alive. I think it sucks that my parents had me and didn't ask if I wanted to be here. And I hate how people treat me while I'm here, but I also refuse to settle. So maybe I just have to hold on. My handwriting is very bad. Maybe I just have to learn to live with it. So with no hope from my parents and no help, I paid for my own car, phone, insurance, food, rent, and made something of myself, but I hate it. I hate myself. I'm unhappy. I'm still waiting for the day my family is back together. But it won't happen because our lifestyles are too different. Okay, so I'll just read the next page because it coincides. 7:16, 11 a.m. I'm tired. I feel drained in every way. I still feel motivated to do well, make money, but only so I can move to California and be with my sister. If I can wait 3 years, I can go with my now partner and he'll be making great income. Or I could break up with him and go now. Even as I write this, I hate both options. I want him with all of his flaws, and I want my sister and my family. Okay, so the journal entries basically, during this time in my life, I hadn't been diagnosed yet with borderline, and I was really struggling with that balance between what I wanted romantically and what I had with my family. So as you guys know, I am very good with my family now. This is many years later, okay? And we did a lot of healing. And a big part of that healing was me realizing, and I, with the help of my therapist, that I had to go towards my joy and I had to accept what that was. And so in order for me to heal from the depression that I had been suffering from all my life, like I didn't, you know, even when I was a young child, I don't really have a lot of time without depression. But at the same time, you know, I have enough memories of non-depressed Brittany to know the difference. And now, of course, I'm non-depressed Brittany. And so there's a difference. But at the time, I was really struggling with like staying in love and staying with my family. And I didn't know how to balance those things. And what I discovered over time, thanks to my therapist, was that I had to look for my joy. And my joy just happened to end up mostly with my family. So what I discovered is that the person that I was dating at the time, anyone that I've ever dated ever, if we didn't end up together, there was a reason. And it was mostly because we weren't making each other happy. And I know from my track record that I am in love with broken people. And I have been a broken person. And I have suffered from depression and anxiety. I do have borderline personality disorder. I have not always been a perfect person. And I haven't always treated myself with the dignity that I do now and in the way that I do now. So I think, you know, in every way possible, respecting the fact that I've really interacted with real humans and that my life story is intertangled or intertwined with all these other people, I want to talk to you about my personal experience with my depression, not as, and my story, but not as a reflection of the people in my life, but as a reflection of who I am. Because remember, the people in my life are on their own journey, and I am the thing that's common in all of them. So I need to be the thing that's examined, right? And I'm doing this for myself. If this helps you, that's great. At this point in the podcast, I do just have to send out a little bit of a warning for people who maybe are in the middle of depression or maybe dealing with depression. This may or may not be helpful to you. I'm a very specific kind of personality type. In the Myers-Briggs world, like, right, I'm a commander. I'm very aggressive. I'm very specific. I'm very, you know. So the way I talk is going to be comforting to people like me, but I'm not sure how other people will handle it. So just keep it in mind a little bit. And if, of course, you're feeling a little on edge and you're feeling a little like life is a little too much, you know, check out the links down below for a phone number you can call for some support. Because remember, I'm a big proponent in being realistic about our life and examining ourselves objectively, but also being in tune with our feelings and how things are impacting us. In my 20s, as I read these journals now in my 30s, but reflecting on 20s Brittany, I realized she just didn't have the tools that I have now. So she didn't have the ability to literally understand mental health the way she does now, human beings the way she does now. Every year, hopefully, we're getting a little wiser and we have better tools. But in these journals, I literally say to myself, Brittany, why are they doing this? Why are the people around us doing this? Why aren't we doing this? How do we do this? Why aren't we happy? I'm asking myself those questions constantly. I was in such a confusion. Indiana Jones, Indiana Jones, Indiana Jones, do not scratch Mama's wall. Why is this my life? Why do we invite things into our life that destroy everything around us? Oh my God, I love my cats so much. And maybe that's it. When you love something so much, you let them destroy little parts of you just a little bit. But in our relationships with our friends and loved ones, hopefully the people who are around don't destroy us. But sometimes they do and they impact us and it causes a bigger issue. So my depression is a consequence of my borderline. So when I got diagnosed with borderline, it became clear to me that once I had gotten a hold on that, it would get a hold on everything else. The people in my life had been concerned that I had chronic depression, something that would stay with me forever, but I didn't. I ended up having very environmental depression, something that was a reaction to the environment I was in. So I have been depression-free, if that's how you want to say it, since October of 2019. Basically, October of 2019, most of my symptoms subsided. I ended up leaving an environment that is really toxic for me, leaving a past partner that was toxic for me, leaving a life that was toxic for me. I took a break from the internet. I went away. I did my thing. I was on Patreon at the time. A lot of people were still in tune with my story, but I took time off. I really just like disappeared into my head. I really examined myself. I had an ego death beyond. I had a few experiences that led me down a path that I had to make a decision. I had to come to a conclusion and I was going to die, basically. The depression had gotten so bad, and there were definitely moments in my life in which the depression had moods in and of itself. Like sometimes my depression would be a lot of sadness, and sometimes it would be emptiness, and sometimes it would even be just like Ghost in the Shell. Like I was just living this ghost, you know, I was just like kind of walking around this script of a person. And then some days it would just be a full fledged turn into like a suicidal dance of trying to drown myself in a bathtub. I haven't had a easy life, but I haven't had the worst life, right? It's like a balance of being humble enough to recognize that I've struggled, but not enough to think that, oh my God, I had it bad as, like my mom had it definitely worse than I did, and her mom had it worse than I did. And so I'm always going to be grateful for where I am now. But there was a time in which my depression, because it had moods, would manifest differently. Like sometimes it was romantic. Sometimes it was really intimate. Sometimes it was like a lover kind of like standing behind me and caressing me and moving me slowly in my moods and bringing me down like a dementor in a hooded, you know, beautiful flowing cape that would come behind you and slowly seduce any happiness out of you. But it was kind of beautiful. I kind of loved it. I kind of like Phantom of the Opera loved being depressed, you know? And I think a big part of me getting better was recognizing that I would miss depressed Britney. And sometimes I do. Sometimes if I'm being completely like forthcoming with you, I miss depressed Britney. And I miss her because I think in some ways she was really authentic. She would say things so raw, so petty, that they would feel really good to say out loud. But, you know, when you meditate on things and you come back and you think about it, you realize like, okay, that's not really how I feel. But sometimes you just want to feel that raw. I think of love that way. I think of when you're dating somebody that way, when you're with someone in your inner circle, my family, my friends, they can come to me and say the most disgusting things out loud in the whole world as a way to express how they feel without actually having it stain who they are as a person. Because I know that we feel as human beings temporarily some really negative thoughts sometimes, and I know that the world doesn't want to admit it out loud because we all want to pretend we're super great people all the time, but I am a little too lazy for that, so I'm just not gonna do it. And we all have moments where the thoughts in our head are not great, but what really makes a person is their actions. And so for me, I really heavily am watching people. What I watched in myself, what I observed in myself, was that my environment impacted everything. But also in terms of healing, I needed a stable environment that allowed me to focus on my emotions that were out of control. But I also needed to be able to work. So I had to first learn how to make myself stable financially in order to spend the time to work on my emotions. That's not going to be everyone's journey, but it meant that I lived with depression for a very long time while I was working versus somebody who might maybe has different resources than I do. They could have actually gone to therapy maybe much younger or worked on themselves and then decided to try to tackle it. Oh, Brittany's bad circulation is coming in. Hold on, I got to move. Oh. And this is why I do the podcast on the floor now, because, oh, it allows me to move my legs. So my concern with how I want to talk about depression today is always remembering that depression is going to be really subjective to the person. It's going to be specific to the person. So I'm not talking about it in a black and white way. I don't mean to sound that way. If I do, I'm just trying to describe to you sort of my experiences with it. Depression is, I feel like, one of the most relatable concepts, because I do think at some point in a person's life, they experience depression. Even if it's for just like a week, I don't care. Like someone dies, you feel it, it could happen. But it's kind of a moment where your brain is trying to process the very unbelievable reality around you. Because it makes you feel often like you're out of control. It makes you feel like there's no direction to move into because there's no happiness or emotion to move off of. For me, when I'm depressed, it feels sort of like I'm alienated from everyone around me, even if I'm surrounded, of course. It feels like I'm trying to look for color in a gray world so I know what direction to go into, but I haven't seen color in a really long time. It feels also like a hug, like I'm being held by somebody who keeps telling me that I'm the most precious and beautiful thing to them, and that because they really love me, they'll never let me go. And I kind of love the obsessive nature of depression, which is why I think depression is so romantic and why you have so many emo couples and why you have so many toxic relationships that feel really good, because depression can kind of feel powerful sometimes. Because when I'm depressed, I don't feel afraid. I feel empty. When I'm depressed, I'll take long walks in the dark. When I'm depressed, I'll really overdo it with drugs. When I'm depressed, you know. So it's been a really long time for me to go without being depressed. If it's 2021 now, my last real feeling of depression was in 2019. For me, that's the longest I've ever gone in my whole life because I've had it since I was so young. I was a young queer kid. I was so anxious about coming out. Of course, I was depressed most of my life. I thought I was going to kill myself. I literally thought I was going to die by 35. I thought I was just going to take my own life and it was going to be all kosher, you know? But I traveled and I socialized and I met people and I figured, well, if I was going to die anyways, I might as well have a lot of fun while I'm here. So I didn't really get my life together until this last couple years because I actually could. You know, I'm picking up guitar. I'm trying to learn Japanese. I'm, you know, trying to be a plant mom. P.S. Most of these are fake. I know a lot of you think they're real. The real plants are outside in the sun. Like, I can grow things in this room. Not yet, but I'm working with my nursery to try to grow things in my room. I don't have a lot of windows. Anyways. Oh my gosh, it made me lose my train of thought, what I just thought of. Actually, perfect time. Let's take a little bit of a break if that's okay. It is okay. I'm going to do it anyways. And I will be right back.
Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence?
Me too.
Join us on Patreon for just $1 to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just $1, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks. Bye.
All right, so let's talk about emo couples and depression. There is a romanticism to depression that obviously exists in anime and novels, romantic movies. We do love toxicity to some extent, and I think that's just because it reflects sort of where we are in our life. Obviously, I think the reason why young people get the leeway of having crazy, ridiculous, almost toxic relationships when they're young is because we all kind of make the assumption that we're going to grow out of them. But I don't know if you recently heard that there's a project happening with like Pamela Anderson's story. And I think that's really interesting that in media, we're going to tell some of the stories of some of the most toxic couples that we watched growing up. For me, when I think back on like a healthy couple versus like a toxic couple, we are given examples of these toxic romantic couples that had high chemistry, high romanticism, but the drop from that adrenaline rush is so extreme, it just has to be toxic by nature. I've been in one of those relationships. I understand the height of toxicity and then coming down from it. And it's like, how do we grow out of that? Well, a big part of growing up is changing and actually like earning the right to be called a grown-up. And so much of that is our mental health. Like so much of that is a journey. Often depression can be such a, it's such a large spectrum of an experience that you can do some things to narrow it down. So don't get overwhelmed, okay? Because, you know, there's a way to narrow it down what kind of depression you're dealing with. You can go get official tests or you can do little experiments at home. I always say if you're going to start off easy, do experiments at home, right? And this is going to give you a direction of being able to identify the depression you're experiencing to kind of know how to handle it. I noticed that with mine, in order to tackle the romantic depression that was sort of comforting to me, I had to find a healthy outlet for comfort. And a big part of that was philosophy. Because a lot of my emo depression came through like music I would listen to or stages of being that I was in, which would attract me to specific people for romantic partnership or friendship. Because I was around people who could understand me temporarily. But now that I'm healed and now that I'm trying to signify a different stage in life, I'm experiencing something that's a little bit more tangible. Meaning that I've earned the right to say that here is my life and here is how it's changed. And here is how I made it through the depressive experience that I had. So what I started to do was in order to get here, I simply start tackling the basics of being a human in terms of health. So drinking enough water, getting enough sleep, exercising during the day. And of course, eating, drinking, sleeping, eating, food, that kind of stuff. So basically getting those things tackled led me to narrowing my depression down to environmental because it was so impacted by those things. So I discovered, and I know it sounds crazy, but if I do not eat every 2 hours, like if I do not have a snack, I will get cranky, then I'll get hangry. And then if it goes too long, like if I go a whole day without eating and it's not a day where, you know how you wake up some days and you just do not want food? It's not one of those days. It's a day where I do want food and I cannot get food for whatever reason. Like I will slump myself after a day or two straight into depression and then straight into an episode. The other day I had gone a whole day without food and I was really busy and I just didn't have time to like sit down and like, okay, Brittany, you know, do something. I was just like working. And I noticed myself starting to get fatigued. And I was like, oh no, it's going to happen. You can tell when your body's being impacted. Okay. So you can do these simple things and narrow it down. Now, if everything in your life is just so perfect, like literally your health's on point, your relationships, your life, your job, everything, and you still feel depression, you should see a doctor. See if it's a chemical issue. See if it's a thyroid issue. See if it's an issue with X, Y, and Z. I don't know what it is, but it could be something. But there is so much more power in our life. We have so much more power in our lives by doing the basics first. Take it into your hands to do the basics first. So acknowledge what kind of depression you have and then kind of do the basics to tackle it, of course. So for me in my life, depression, other than a romantic entanglement, was something that was also a superpower to stay away from people. It was a way for me to put up walls and feel safe by disassociating. Because if I was depressed enough, I could feel emptiness about everything, which was sort of safer than feeling too much about everything. Because I have borderline. So borderline is like that extreme of just like, I either feel a lot of emotions like heavily, or if I'm depressed, I feel no emotions at all. And I could never find the balance between the two. So my journey out of depression was my journey out of borderline. Once I could get my borderline under control and stop the episodes from happening, my depression no longer was an issue because my environment was healthy. So my mental illnesses are very impacted by my ability to process the environment around me. And obviously I'm a human. So if like, let's say you just have a really busy month or a really hectic life. And like I did a few months ago with like a lot of illnesses in the family and deaths, a lot of it can be put on your shoulders and you can get naturally exhausted and fall into a depression that's like based off of your environment. All of those things are a thing. But for somebody like myself who lived my whole 20s, my whole teens depressed, my whole adolescence through the lens of this like emo, suicidal, depressive lens, the way I talked about my life was only through that lens. So many of you guys know me from early YouTube and you know that I used to preach anti-procreation. Like I would be anti-making new babies because I thought one, it impacted the environment, and two, there were babies who needed to be adopted and three, that it wasn't fair to bring a child into the world without its consent. And now I don't believe that. Now I understand that the reality is that when two people are in love, that our natural desire as an animal species that we are and as a free and intellectual thinking being is to come together to make love, to make a baby. Like a baby is a beautiful thing that you can do when you're in love to show that compatibility, to show that love. It doesn't have to be universal for everybody, but I know that I fall into that category of human that sees procreation as the ultimate thing. Like, hold on. For me, I do see, like, when I meet my human and we come together and we create this baby, it's a legacy. It's not a legacy like making $1 billion. I don't care about that. It's not a legacy like everyone will know our name. I don't care about that. What I mean to say is like, I'm continuing something. And I would count that even if I adopted, because I know that about myself. I am also one of those humans that I adopt people. I take people into my care and I recognize them as mine, even if they were not related. So I do believe it heavily in chosen family, but I do think that it's special and rare and that it means you have like a special connection. So ultimately, right, so much of our power comes with our understanding of ourselves. And I cannot be mad at young Brittany for not having those answers. And you can't be mad at yourself for not having those answers, right? Like every piece of information we take in is either going to help or hinder us. One of the reasons I don't like political spheres is because they're not very big on sharing. Have you noticed that a lot of meditation circles, a lot of people, yes, they create cliques and people become enemies. But so much of like, as an example, on the internet, in the groups I'm in, like I am spiritual, but I'm an atheist, right? But like the Wicca people like me, the like tarot card readers like me, like every little subgroup of spiritualism, yoga people like me, like we seem to get along well enough that I'm like, okay, we have something we can share together. But in political spheres, I feel like it's very much like our way or the highway, and that's not going to help in your spiritual growth as like a human. And I feel like it leads to a lot of anxiety and depression. I feel like it's very a toxic environment. And when you're in it, they will lead you down a path of having like a lot of negative energy around you, a lot of negative people, a lot of selfish people around you. And it won't serve you. You know what I mean? It's funny. There was one point in my career where I was like the height of my mental illness spiral, just like the height of my depression, the height of me just feeling like constantly like whiplash, like from my emotions. And it was also a career moment where I could take an opportunity with a career move and put myself in an environment with people that could lead me down more handshaking opportunities, but less joyful opportunities, or I could just like pull away. And it was actually a woman, a black woman who I had met through, you know, just activism circles. And she looked at me one day and just asked me, like, why am I constantly putting myself in an environment with people that don't see me in any way? And I said, what do you mean? It's like for my career and my job. And she was like, yes, but there are so many other ways to excel at your job without putting yourself in an environment with hundreds of people who do not understand you. And I was like, really? She goes, get out, girl. Get out of this system you're in. Get out of the politics. Go find what you're supposed to be doing. And I appreciate her so much because she is a woman of color who grew up sort of similarly to me. So we have a lot of things that overlap with feeling like we're always in two worlds. Like when you grow up as a third culture kid or as a child with like immigrant parents or a child like or being like passing white passing or anything like that, it is a different experience. And it's not bad or good or different to me. I think all of our journeys are important and special, but they're just so freaking different. Like trying to pretend they're the same is so difficult unless we're talking about those overlapping moments of like mental health and mental illness. So on top of the advice from my therapist who told me to seek my joy, and now this woman that I trusted also telling me to seek my joy, I did not take the deal that I had, that opportunity that I had. And though I don't think it would have impacted me very negatively, it just would have delayed where I was. So I'm happy I didn't take it, but I, you know, it wouldn't have been the worst thing, but I'm happy that I just skipped that lesson and I came here to this one, which was that my joy was not what I thought it would look like, but it was better than I could have dreamed. That my joy was nature, my joy was solace, my joy was country, my joy was not politics, my joy was philosophy, my joy was wondering why things were the way they were and then figuring it out. So not just the pondering of things are bad, so this must be this, or things are bad, what do we do? But to ask ourselves why. Why do I have depression? Why am I suffering? Why do I feel disconnected from the world? Why do I feel sort of romantically entangled with my mental illness? Why do I kind of want to keep it? Why do I kind of like when I self-harm? Like, what are all these questions and how do we answer them? It's like the podcast is a great example. I tried to do a podcast before with my friend Evie Lupine, who's fantastic. You guys should check her out. Links down below for BDSM on alternative education. But Evie and I used to do a podcast about BDSM and it was really cool while we did it, but I wasn't as hands-on with it. You know, that was more like her thing and the other people on the podcast. And so now though, I realize it's such a good way to explain long form ideas to have this conversation. Like if I made a YouTube video and I said depression's kind of romantic and then I use like really fast speeds and funny clips to kind of explain it, it would just be like a lot of other videos we've seen. But when I say that depression is romantic, I think a lot of you know what I mean by that, right? Because I'm on Tumblr, girl, sometimes, you know, I see Twitter posts, I see things on the internet. Where was I the other day? Oh, I love Angels of Death. It's an anime, but there was like this whole thing I found. I do want to make a video about this, but that is an anime that's kind of like romantic depression, sort of a lot of it is kind of just that feeling. And I love it. It's one of my favorites, but a lot of the fan art is very like borderline awkward, toxic, but not really. I don't know. It's hard to explain, except I think you know what I mean when I say we watch people expressing the darkest thoughts in our head through art. So it feels like they understand us. But what they understand is their own depression. You know, when you get sleep paralysis, how we all experience it the same but different. Like, I get sleep paralysis, and when I Google it on the internet, there's like a specific picture that I always see of a guy like over, like on top of a chest, like squeezing someone's throat. That's very similar to what I see. Or sometimes I'll see like cloaked figures. Sometimes I have different images. And it's funny because you tell my mom about my sleep paralysis and she goes, Bati, it's demons. You know, oh my gosh, what is this? And then you ask a dream analysis person or fucking anyone else. And it's just sleep paralysis. But sleep paralysis is comforting to me. I know it can be creepy and intimidating, and I know people don't love it, but I kind of like it in the same way I like a bad trip. I had a homie reach out and ask about marijuana, and they really want to do weed, but they don't want to have a bad trip. And I tell them, don't do marijuana if you don't want to have a bad trip, because I can't guarantee, you can't guarantee, no one can guarantee what the trip is going to be like. We can only just guesstimate. But for me, my rule of thumb is, if it's going bad, just ride it out. Just ride it out. That's how I feel about life. So it kind of helped, I think, in examining my journals to see a pattern that I noticed, that every time I wrote about how bad my depression was, or how bad the suicide was, or how bad everything was, I just kept writing, but I guess I'll keep going. And it was so helpful, because I do kind of wonder how much of my brain really wanted to commit suicide. Because now I'm not suicidal. I haven't been suicidal since 2019. I feel really good about my life. I feel really good about my choices. I think everything, the way I suffered, makes sense. Like, I don't feel angry or upset about my past anymore. I'm not upset about existing. I understand that my parents made me out of love, that I will make my children out of love, that I will raise my children out of love. I understand that life is unpredictable, but to act so narcissistic as to believe that we are like the first generation of humans that hates being alive is just silly. Like, everyone suffers. Human beings go in a cycle. We exist. It's always chaos. The thing that you can make sure isn't chaos is you. So how do you make yourself less chaotic? And a big part of it is like doing the basics. And I really can't press this enough, because it's just something I did not believe in my 20s. I did not believe that doing the basics was going to change my mental health. And then my therapist, you know, she would tell me, the way she gave advice was so professional. She would say things like, hold on. She would say things like, okay, I don't care if you break up with your boyfriend or not. The point is, what are you doing for you? Are you joyful? You know, because like, she's like, I can't tell you who to love or not love. What I can tell you, though, is that some things are better for you than other things, or that maybe if you're doing this and you feel this every day, maybe there's something in your environment that's not making it helpful. Like, I remembered one time, as an example, I had been really stressed. I was paying the bills. I was really stressed. I was living with a partner at the time in this like 400 square foot apartment. It was probably like 475. We're in this small apartment, and I'm working a lot, and I'm just exhausted. My mental health is in decline majorly. I'm just a mess all the time. And finally, a whole bunch of things happen. I go away for a while, and I come home to chaos. Like, I went to go see my parents. I came home to like chaos. And it was funny, because when I went home to my parents, it was after all these journal entries. It was after a whole bunch of things happened that were really bad. I went home to my parents. I got a reset, like a reset out of my environment. When I came back, I came home to chaos. And it was a reminder of, do you see the contrast in your life? Because when we're in it, guys, when we're drowning in our depression or drowning in our bad habits, it's really hard to see what's going on. Like, you really got to zoom out. When I had my ego death in the national forests while I was traveling, smoking marijuana, I had a life shift, because I was, in contrast to my previous life, able to see the differences. So much of our depression, so much of our journey is predicated on our knowledge of where we are. So many people looked at me and said, Brittany, you have chronic depression. Brittany, you will always have depression. And then I went to therapy, and bam, bada boom, bada bing, don't have depression. So we have to be careful that, yes, the people around us can tell us, hey, you seem depressed, and they can have an accuracy there without it needing to follow, I think you'll have this forever. because my belief system is that most of us will not suffer for most of our lives, that most of us will get better, that most of us will find cures. And there is a way around it. Your pain might be ongoing. You might have suffering even though you've done your best. But like that isn't going to be common, and it shouldn't be common. And I hope that the people who have chronic pain understand that, like, that's what makes your journey yours. And I assume you don't want to trade cards with me, right? I assume you don't want people to suffer like you do. So let's hopefully work together to give everyone the help they need to kind of move forward with life without being bitter that some of us didn't get the same hand, right? Like, there's so many anime stories about this. Like, you can't be bitter over what other people had that you didn't. What you can do is use this as a moment to be humble, because really, if you had humility, you cannot have bitterness. So that's what I'm working on. I still have parts of me that have lingerings of bitterness. They're very small, and I know they're getting smaller, so I don't worry about them. If they were getting larger, if they were lingering longer, I'd be very worried. But because I can see them going away and it's just taking time, every day is a little bit better, I know that eventually I'll have the proper amount of humility to maybe even avoid bitterness as long as I've had it. Because I've always been a bitter person, like in the sense that I've been able to hold grudges very well. I've always been in conflict with people. And a big part of that is because I am unlike other people. Like, I admit that fully, that I'm the issue, that I am unlike other people, but I'm very like some people. And so I just, like, when I'm in the environment around my people, I'm good to go. They're good to go. It's a healthy environment. And yes, we still are able to hold each other accountable, but because we know the context of our characters, we can judge it appropriately, even with mental health. Like, I have an inner circle that very much is kind of in each other's mental health business, where we say, we can back off if you need us to, but hey, you're exhibiting symptoms of depression. I feel, like, comforted knowing that I have family members that can come to me, and that I trust them to observe me in a way that goes, oh, maybe I am working on symptoms, let me check. I don't trust the internet. I don't trust people who aren't in my life. I give literally no credit to anyone who has not seen me or involved with me, because obviously the context of my whole day is off the camera. But we do that in life. We allow other people to tell our story to us instead of telling your story to other people. It's a balance, right? So don't panic if somebody in your life says, hey, I think you might have depression. Also, don't panic if you think you might. There are so many paths to recovery. It's insane. But also acknowledge at what point you maybe are keeping it around to feel comforted. The other day I talked to a friend about this, you know, because as you may know, and this is a disclaimer, that I am an adult, that I have studied, that I feel very able to handle my consequences of my actions, that these are my stories and my actions alone, and this is not me encouraging you to do anything I say that I do. But I have recently dabbled in the idea of using drugs, specifically shrooms, to play with the idea of depression. Now, this is a little bit I'm going to Britney-esque this sort of like game here, but understand what I'm about to explain is heavily rooted in consent and knowledge of what's about to be possibly done. Okay, so I'm working on this idea of utilizing like BDSM negotiations with the balance of drugs and meditation to play with depression. The reason for this is, one, I'm very curious on how my depression works in my own brain. And two, I'm very curious to see if I could make myself depressed, even if I'm not. My life is good. I have no reason to complain about anything. I'm very humbled and grateful for the way that my life has turned out. BDSM is predicated on consent. One of the issues I see with online BDSM culture is just how easily it is for people to slip through the cracks, predators and things like that. But also how easy it is for people to be misguided in the lifestyle. So if you don't know, BDSM can be practiced in a spiritual way, which I try to use it as, a means of meditation. And BDSM has a thing where it's called a scene. It has a beginning and an end. It's a time in which you and another person, traditionally speaking, interact in a particular way for a particular time. And then someone can safe word out of the scene, or the scene naturally ends. Well, you know, just as it does sometimes. What I would like to do is... The reason I love BDSM, and I think it's a much better way to explore things, is that if you can do this, and your brain has to be trained to be able to, you can enter into a scene in BDSM where, like, you say start, and from that moment on, you are not you. You are a person in your body, but you get to have an interaction with another person that's not predicated on what's happening out in the outside world or who even you are. This is a fun but can be dangerous exploration into identity and the self and mental illness. So I was thinking of creating a scene in which I had a beginning and an end, in which I would take shrooms and in which I would get off of shrooms because eventually it would wear out, in which I would listen to my most depressive music, set up a scene of what I used to do as a ritual when I was depressed. Because for me, my mental illnesses were very ritualistic. I'm sure many of you have felt this, where when I was depressed, I would act a certain way, dress a certain way, smell certain things, eat certain things, listen to certain things. My actions, like, you could tell what state of mind I was in based off of what I was doing. I still do that now, but obviously I'm not depressive anymore, and I haven't had a borderline issue, you know, since 2019. So for me, it's like I would be curious if I could recreate the feeling of mental illness by recreating the ritual of mental illness. So I would utilize BDSM and my knowledge of it, utilize what I know about psychology, utilize what I know about myself, and then get myself into an environment where I could recreate this thing, and then I could safely end the scene and get out of it. So for me, Brittany's brain, I am very good at putting everything in boxes. I've been very good about that my whole life. I do not doubt my skill set. And the reason I say this is because I've put it to the test. I think sometimes we want to pretend like we're told, like, I always imagine I'm Urza Scarlet. From Fairy Tail, I've been referencing her a lot. I love Urza Scarlet. She's very, like, the knight in shiny armor. She's very, like, knows who she is. She's powerful. She's determined. She has strong values. But I'm not an Urza Scarlet. I just admire her so much, and I'm always striving. I feel like I identify more or less with, like, a Mary Jane, like somebody who has more of an issue with the balance between the good and the bad, the demon and the angel. But Urza's an angel. Urza's a Gryffindor. I am a Slytherin. Do we get what I'm saying? But depression hits all of us in different ways. Like, I've got a brother who I would say has probably never experienced depression in the way that most people have, but has experienced just enough to kind of get it. But he calls it extreme sadness. But he also has had a life that has sort of been like the lottery hand. Like, he really does have the lottery of life. And I'm so happy for him. I could not have gone to a better person. He's so wonderful. And I never think, like, oh, this doesn't make sense for who he is. The universe blessed him in conjunction with who he is. I used to love to read books when I was younger. I still love to read books. But when I was younger, I really read books. Like, a book a day, 2 books a day, 3 books a day, no problem. And I was obsessed with books on suicide and depression and mental health. You know, Running with Scissors, Million Little Pieces, all these books that allowed us to explore. What was that book, guys? Was it called Anonymous? It was literally just like a suicidal girl's like diary, basically. That was very popular when I was in high school. And it's funny because I remember depression being this really like taboo, but again, romantic subject when I was younger, where people wanted to feel like they were the girl who wore the dark hoodie and the eyeliner who was like drawing on her notepad. And then the hot guy would come up to her and finally see her. And then all of a sudden, like, I don't know, he would see her through her darkness. Like, yeah, that was a big tropey image I think a lot of my girl friends around me had. Like, we were these it girls, or the trope of the manic pixie girl. You know, it's just, it is what it is. I do think tropes represent a large part of, like, where we are in our stages. I don't think it's wrong that girls are manic pixie girls. I think it's wrong if you're doing that at 30, right? Like, you want to have a certain time in your life where you grow up. And so the problem is that you can get behind in certain things, but it's okay. You can always catch up. It is what it is. We're all on a different journey. And catching up is only subjective to how you see that in your life. So for myself, if I was still a manic pixie girl, I would think that I would have failed. I'm glad that I stopped it before 30, or like at 30, my life changed. I'm glad that my 30s have been completely different than my 20s. And I know some people who are maybe watching my life, maybe it looks like I'm repeating the same habits and mistakes, but holy crap, if that's what you see, like, I don't know, boo, because I think it's pretty apparent that things have changed. But maybe that's another reflection, too. Maybe we can't see the change in people if we ourselves have not changed. Because it is hard to almost remember what it was like to be that other Brittany, to be that other person, to be that other version of myself. I think about that all the time. Like, I wish I could feel what it was like to be that Brittany again, but I can't feel it. My life is completely different. Like, I look around at my environment and I just think, like, wow, cool. Like, it's not that sad anymore. My friend and I were just talking yesterday, and she and I have been friends since, you know, our early 20s, and we used to live in San Diego together, and then we lived in Seattle together, and like, we're just, you know, we've been best friends for just a very long time. And we were talking yesterday and catching up, you know, because May's both our birthday months, and we were doing a little birthday Skype. And we were talking about the shitty apartments we have lived in and the depressive episodes and our mental health and how we put up with each other and how we managed to stay friends and how could we have managed to be so close for so long and so different, you know, like we're just so different in so many ways, but so the same in our values. And so that's why really why we're friends. But we were talking about the shitty, shitty apartments we've lived in. Guys, I have lived, the ways I have lived in my 20s are so outrageously disgusting. And it is so funny because a big part of it is like, I remember being young and just thinking this does not matter how gross I am. Do you guys remember that episode? Oh my God, talk about depression. Do you guys remember that episode of Sex and the City where Carrie's like in her really negative, depressive state over Big and she starts dating like 20 year olds and she's in her 30s. And she goes to bed with this guy and she wakes up in his apartment and she's like, oh no, waking up in a man's, like a 30-year-old man's apartment and a 20-year-old man's apartment is very different. And this man was disgusting. Food boxes everywhere, shoes, clothes, no more toilet paper, graffiti on the walls, used the last of the toilet paper to make a coffee filter. So she had to pee without toilet paper. Guys, I have lived that like that in my 20s. My 20s would have been a furniture we found on the side of the road mixed in with shitty Walmart art, mixed in with like fancy was buying something from IKEA, you know, compared to where I am now. Like, oh my gosh, my 20s were disgusting. I could never. That's why when I say I don't know if I could date someone in their 20s, I'm imagining me in my 20s and I was disgusting. But that's because I was a depressed emo young person that was working 50 hours a week and not seeing any point to anything. It was horrible, but at the same time, it was the time of my life. It was kind of like Perks of Being a Wallflower, also a great reference of a book and movie, highly recommend. But Perks of the Wallflower, it impacted me so much as a person, from reading the book to watching the movie. Just that idea of like, you're living this really crazy time in your youth where you make a lot of mistakes and you might regret it later, but you still feel it in the moment. Do you remember in Perks of Being a Wallflower, the main character is high on brownies and he turns to the girl with the shaved head and he goes, I think you're going to regret that. And that's just so funny because it's so true. Like, we look at ourselves all the time and I'm like, we're going to regret this. Girls, I look at my old videos all the time and I think to myself, girl, how did you not know you were going to regret this? And I just don't. Like, even now, maybe I'll regret all of this. Maybe I'll regret everything I've done. But it feels pretty good right now. And sometimes that's what depression feels like to me. It feels really good right now. And so maybe it's good enough. But I had no idea when I was in depression that it could get better. And right now in this moment, I'm so happy. The idea of it getting better I think I would die. I think I would literally explode from happiness because I don't think you should be that happy. Like, I'm very happy, guys. I know where my money's coming from. I know how to eat. I have a roof over my head. I have all the basics taken care of. My family and I are really, really close right now. Everyone is really good. Everyone is healthy. I'm out there in the world and seeing, talking to people, being, you know, I'm doing my thing. So if this isn't like, and I feel so much at peace in life. I feel so good about everything that I'm like, yeah, life makes sense. Life is good. Life is a good place. How could I be happier than this? I don't know. But what I'm trying to say, I guess, is that when you are depressed and you know it's depression, like, come on, we know, right? We know when we're fucking in it. It's awful. It's a horrible thing. You know when you're in it. I want you to always remember there's something more than this, even though it can, no matter how many times they say it, your brain is never going to understand the feeling of it when you're there. But there's so much more to this and you just got to keep going. You got to do the basics and you got to keep going. I know for me, it was really difficult in my 20s to do, to drink water, as an example. It's still my biggest issue. So I have like this and I just like try to empty. I have to empty it 4 times a day. Like, I have to drink 4 of those at least to meet my minimum. And I'm not going to lie. Like, some days, it's just so hard. I'd rather drink coffee, which is not good for you. It's a diuretic. It's a dehydrate. Like, you just don't want it. You want to drink something nice for you, which is water. So I try very hard to reward myself with coffee. So to say, like, okay, 1 cup a day is absolutely required. You may have up to 3 cups a day if you drink all 4 of your bottles. You can have 2 cups a day if you drink 2 of your bottles. So it's like a way to like incentivize myself, because as much as I can claim like I'm a super grown adult, I have all my shit together, I just am super disciplined. The truth is to maintain my discipline, I have to incentivize myself. I have to tell myself this is for something more. I'm working out to be strong and to literally boost my OnlyFans. Because I'm going to be real, the OnlyFans people I follow, like the ones who are more acrobatic, I love them. Like I want to do pole. I have to be stronger than I am now. You know what I mean? I want to get into like doing the splits, and I've been practicing every day. So eventually, like in the next, you know, so while, I want to meet certain requirements, and that involves, well, everything I'm doing now. But there's an incentive. I have to tell myself every time I feel like giving up, like this is for something you're investing in. And it's the same for everything that I do, is that for now, I have real tangible goals and I'm seeing progress. It is so hard for someone like me who has very little patience to believe that the pain I'm in today is really going to matter in 6 months. But I also now have tangible evidence that those things do work, that being patient and actually doing your thing every day will eventually get you what you want, because I've seen it work. So in some ways we have to, especially when we're depressed, sit down with ourselves and remind ourselves that we have evidence. And if you don't, you need to make evidence, okay, that these things are possible. Moving on is possible. Okay. Now, when is it safe to miss depression? I feel like it's safe to miss depression when you think of it as a fond memory, but way outside of your reach. So the reason I brought up the fact that I wanted to do this little BDSM scene with my mental health was because though I am thinking about it, I know I'm very far off from doing it. I know I'm not quite there. I believe heavily in meditation. I believe heavily in the mind. I believe heavily in sober meditation. And I do believe that we control so much of how our brain processes information. I know there's a strong belief in the world that we're always just reacting, but I just don't believe that because I exercise free will every day. I know I'm not just reacting, but I can recognize those times when I am reacting. Like, guys, you know what I mean, right? When you're sitting in a conversation with someone, it's going good, but all of a sudden the energy changes, there's a switch, and now everything they say is sort of hurtful and pointed, and you're like, what is going on? And then after a while, it becomes like, you know, you feel that anger, that little bit of low trust that comes in, then you react. That could be something that like hits you so fast you don't think about it. What I'm trying to say is we need to be in control of ourselves. And I do think there's a way to do it where we see it coming before it's even coming. We're like, one day I woke up the other day and I was like, oh, I'm in a bad mood. And then I was like, oh, I'm going to be in a bad mood all day. And all day everyone was in a bad mood. And sometimes I do believe, as Rugrats would say, I woke up on the wrong side of the bread. Like, it felt like that, where you do wake up on the wrong side of the bread and it makes you wonder, what is the significance of this moment? What is it trying to tell me? Itaroski talks about this, the creator of Holy Mountain, the director. He says that he uses tarot, and he has like a YouTube channel, it's so cute, where he says he uses tarot to kind of reach the subconscious, to reach that part of our brain that is trying to tell us something that maybe we're not just aware of. And so it's not that tarot itself has magic, but that spiritualness that feel, the magic we feel in the world, we have no other language for it. And maybe it is a form of magic, but we are misunderstanding it. There's something in a human brain that is super observant and utilizes tools around us to bring other answers out that we couldn't find otherwise. Like I said, I'm an atheist. I'm not very into the woo-woo, but I'm heavily into meditation. And I do think it impacts us positively. But I think you have to kind of be open to it being magical for it to work. How do I say this? Depression. Depression is kind of like magic. It's kind of like a superpower, where if you utilize depression as a means of understanding yourself, as using it as a way of your mind telling you something's up, then you can use it as a tool. But the problem with depression, and because it's all encompassing, is that it makes us feel like there's nothing we can do. So I'm hoping that my words will give you something in your subconscious that comes alive in a depressive moment, so you can remember, oh yeah, my body's trying to tell me, my mind is telling me I'm depressed. Like, this experience of depression is a gift because it's telling me something's wrong. My borderline was telling me something was wrong. My depression, anxiety was a it was a spidey sense that was too much for me to handle. So eventually, when I realized what was wrong and I took care of it, these things went away because I didn't need the bell alarms anymore. I didn't need the alarms. So I think in those ways, okay, we can look at depression as a tool to know ourselves better. So many people, you know, and I really highly recommend doing the Patreon calls. I love it so much to talk to you guys one-on-one. But so many of you guys reach out to me and you talk about how you're afraid that you have a mental health issue, or you're afraid, oh, I have to get this diagnosed, or you're afraid that this will be like, people always tell me, oh, I'm surprised you were happy that you got diagnosed with borderline because that's one of the bad ones. But getting diagnosed is just a tool to know ourselves better. We're living in the modern age. If you trust your doctors, you're going to experience the, you know, mental health care to the best of the people's ability around you. I saw a few therapists, but I only really saw one the most, and she impacted me the best. Some people misdiagnosed me. It's funny, the therapist I had before her actually wrote me off and said, you do not have borderline. And I said, great, I don't know what that is, so I don't care. But the second therapist was like, nah, dude, it's borderline. And she changed my life by properly diagnosing me, gave me the care, because I got to do DBT, that directly impacted the thing that was my illness. And so it's not that the first therapist meant to misdiagnose me. I don't think that was it. I think she was a little lazy when it came to her job. But I also think she was probably just doing her job. Like, she wasn't really in it for the interest of curing people or helping people. My second therapist, my main therapist, she was fascinated. Just thought the human brain was so interesting. And I could tell because of the way she talked to me that she was less concerned with, like, she was just really concerned with actually getting me better, which was really cool. You know, she really had faith in me based off of my aunt, and she believed me when I spoke. And then she called me out on my bullshit when she could feel it, you know. And a big part of my bullshit is justifying, like, people's bad behavior around me. I had to go from learning how not to justify bad behavior and learning how to accept bad behavior as this is who this person is, without violating my own boundaries. So remember in the episode, I think before that, the trust issue episode, we talked about that picket fence I have up. That picket fence exists with everything, even my own mental illnesses. I always tell my mental illnesses, I am open to you giving me these red flags. I am open to you letting me know I'm depressed, but, you know, I still need boundaries. So I don't want to be overtaken by another mental illness issue. So like a few weeks ago, I was really, really stressed. I had a moment where I, like, you know, I got too much, like I the straw that broke the camel's back too much, which is just kind of normal people stress from, like, life. And then I went like this. I was like, oh, and I self-cared, did my meditation, did my thing, and I was fine. But in the past, if I hadn't taken care of that, it would spiral within 24 hours into, like, a week-long depressive issue or a hardcore BPD episode or something awful where I would just feel completely useless and I would spiral. So many pages of my journal are me telling me that, like, life is hard, it sucks, I hate myself, I feel ugly and stupid, I don't know why people are doing these things. So much of my turmoil came from my confusion of other people. And once I could understand people, I could understand myself so much better. Highly recommend reading books. Highly recommend watching documentaries. Remember, if you don't have the answer right now, it's somewhere in the universe. Somewhere in the universe, all the answers have been, you know, answered. All the questions have been answered, I mean. We just have to find them. And it's gonna, you know, it's going to seem like, okay, I just read a quote. I forget who they attributed it to, but the quote was just basically like, the opinions of 20,000 men are useless if their opinion is on something they don't know about. You know, that philosophy quote that goes around on Instagram all the time. So basically, it's like that idea is that we have to make sure we're getting the right information from the right people, and we have to be consistent. If we believe that truth, you know, there is, like, this idea of objective truth, maybe not in all ways, not in all things, but something can be objective, then we should look for that objective answer. And then we should accept what we can't bring objective answers to. We should accept the subjective. But making sure we get down to the base of everything and then manipulating it from there is much better than keep manipulating it from the top without ever knowing the foundation. I think in life, a lot of people take a rebellious route without knowing the foundation, and that's why they get sloppy. I highly recommend knowing your foundation. Read great philosophers. Read people's thoughts on ethics. understand your idea of a human. Who are you? So when you're given an opportunity to act, you can act with the best information at hand. Depression is like a subjective little thing, right? It's an experience that is temperamental. It's an experience that is situational. It just depends on so much. So remember that my goal for you to take away from this podcast is just that it is going to be subjective to you. And so you have to do the best within your environment to figure out what it's coming from, where it's coming from. Is it really truly out of your control, or is it a matter of gaining control around you to help with the depression? I'm sure there are other things I could talk about, but I'm going to leave it here. Now, remember, next week's episode is on narcissism. And the reason I want to talk about that is because I want to talk to you about how I handled one of my narcissists, the main one. I put them in an anime novel. This would be the boss. So this is like the boss bad guy, like the bad guy we've all been waiting, you know. So this is my narcissist, and I want to talk about them. And I want to be able to explain how I managed to find a boundary with them and without expelling them from my life, because they're in my inner circle. So I have taken it upon myself to always allow this person back into my life according to what we've agreed upon in terms of our social contract. But that's going to be next week. In order to help solidify and maybe give you a heads up on the episode, if you watch Fruits Basket 2019, which is an anime on Funimation, it might also be on Hulu, they have a character named Akito who is the embodiment of a narcissist and also so many other things. And I think it's a really good example and a story that could give you a little bit of a heads up if you want to check it out. But I'm definitely going to talk and reference Fruits Basket, not too heavily, but it might give away some things. So if you feel you want to catch up ahead of time, please do. If you don't want to watch it, you don't have to. The episode will still make sense. Thank you so much for being here. I really do appreciate it. I have had an up and down life. I've not been a perfect person. I've been an absolute hot mess. But if I've learned anything from Paris Hilton, the great philosopher, life is moments, and you can absolutely live a moment, leave a moment, start a new moment. And your girl on top of an empire should know that's hot. Life is possible. And I believe in myself because I've proven to myself, girl gets out of situations. If you were an anime character, who would you be in the series? What anime world would you be a part of? If you're into fiction, what fictional world would you be a part of? If you're in Harry Potter, who would you be? Think of your life in terms of the character tropes around you and maybe come to terms with which one you are and then decide what journey you should go on. Because Frodo and Sam might be hobbits, but they different kind of hobbits. You know what I'm saying? They different people. And so don't freak out. Whether you're Frodo or Sam, you still have a journey and you're still allowed to go on it and you still can have a happy ending. Okay, guys, thank you so much for being here. I appreciate it so much. Please, please, please check out the Spotify. Love that you listen there. And then check out the Patreon. Links down below. All right, talk to you soon. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, 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 dun.